Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Crafter's Son by Matthew B. Berg. Narrated by Kirby Heyborne. 1. The Run. Breeden's small hands worked the net carefully as the sunrise unfolded in fiery arcs across the sky. To his 16-year-old sensibility, it was the most incredible sunrise he had ever seen. Deep reds and purples bled in broad streaks into burnt oranges and yellows above the floodplain to the east. Fully half the world was ablaze in a riot of colors overhead. Rich, earthy smells rose from the lake, and the crispness of early spring cleared the last wisps of lingering sleep he bore from rising so early. With difficulty, he tore himself away from the sky's majesty. He had no time for sunrises right now. He shifted his seat closer to the balance point of his small rowboat and adjusted his grip once again. The net's rough hemp was clammy and pricked the skin of his calloused hands unpredictably as he maintained a steady draw against the weight of the water. Then Breeden noticed the roiling of the water above his net. He was startled at first, the churning mass looking like a thing tentacled and evil. But he quickly realized he could pick out the forms of individual fish sliding over, under, and around each other like a dark, wet fistful of arm-thick worms. Relief from the brief stab of fear and joy at the arrival of the anticipated fish swelled in his chest. The running of the herring had begun. His father had set Breeden upon the course he now followed, in the hopes he would beat the rush of townsfolk who would soon scramble onto the water in anything that floated. The harvest of nearly limitless quantities of fish from these waters over the next 2 weeks would provide food for months to come for many, and a windfall commodity to be distributed by boat and wagon for others. For Breeden and his parents, all the fish from today's catch would be salted and smoked dry for storage. Breeden would catch additional fish during the summer months, which they would eat fresh, but today's bounty, once properly prepared, would last them through the winter, perhaps even until next year's run. It was all Breeden could do to muscle the first haul over the side of his father's rowboat, and the pair of bushel baskets he had brought with him proved woefully inadequate to contain even the first net's catch. But he cast the net two more times and landed two more hauls, each somewhat smaller than the last, before he collapsed at the bow of the sturdy little boat. Only then did Breeden take the time to rest and to admire the sky and the now visible orb of the sun rising above the distant tree line. His boat sat in the middle of the River Woodfall's narrow mouth at the southernmost end of Long Lake. The broad and treeless expanse of the river's floodplain afforded him a wide and unobstructed view of the sun's rise for miles to the east and southeast. A low mist clung to the lake's surface against the far banks, where shade offered it a few more minutes' protection, but the water around him was clear and smooth, reflecting the sky's now fading colors. As he swept his gaze from the south through the east, he caught sight of a will-o'-wisp. The halo-shrouded mass of blue and blue-green lights moved through the air like an erratic school of fish. He watched it for a few more moments before it disappeared. Even the brief sighting made Breeden's heart race. He had seen will-o'-wisps before, though usually at night. But they weren't common by any means, and most people Breeden knew were superstitious of them. Many thought wisps were ill omens, but others, as Breeden, thought they were bits of magic that, should you be able to lay your hands on one, would grant you any wish. He waited to see if it would reappear, and when it didn't, he sighed and looked about once more. Gazing north, Breeden could see several small fishing vessels. Some had sails furled and were engaged in landing the salmon, which lived in the deeper waters of the lake. Others were done with their morning's work on the water and were returning to shore to begin the sorting and cleaning of their catch. Beyond the boats and beyond the range of his eyesight, Breeden knew the lake continued north for many leagues. A small vessel like the ones before him would take as long as 2 or even 3 days to make the trip to the northernmost tip of the aptly named Long Lake. After several minutes of reflection, Breeden reluctantly retrieved the oars and set off for shore. 2. Encounter. It wasn't until he arrived at the pier that Breeden realized he would have a hard time bringing his bounty home without assistance, but he loaded a single bushel basket as full as he could manage and set off anyway. The basket was somewhat more than half full, but it still presented a daunting challenge to Breeden's young frame, and he had to stop at the landward end of the pier and set the basket down to catch his wind. When he straightened once again to pick up his burden, he discovered an old man standing where he'd have sworn none had stood moments earlier. The old man had a thick head of long hair, more white than gray, and long mustaches that ran trimly down below his jaw. His features were strong and firm, and his skin bore the leathery appearance of a man who had spent his life at sea. He wore a half-smile, and his furrowed brow made him look as though he were waiting for someone. Breeden recovered from his surprise and bid the old man good morning.
"Good morning, my son. You bear a heavy burden for one so young."
"Yes, sir. It's the run finally here."
"I can see that."
His half-smile broadened and his eyes crinkled up.
"And it appears as though you've no intention of sharing with anyone else."
Breeden could tell the man was joking, but felt abashed nonetheless.
"I've been out each morning for 9 days. My father would say I've earned the early bird's share."
The old man's smile softened as he looked beneath the sandy mop of hair and into the hazel eyes of the young man before him. He could see the obvious sincerity behind his words.
"As you have, my son. 9 days. You are a persistent one. By your father's bidding or on your own?"
"A bit of both, sir. My father asked me if I needed him this year. Other springs we would go out together, but this time he asked. And when he asked, I got the feeling the right answer was to say no, so I did. He seemed happy, so I figure I made the right decision."
The old man nodded sagely.
"It sounds like your father has raised you well. I'm sure you make him proud."
Breeden smiled, feeling embarrassed and a bit proud from the comment. Too, there was something about the old man and the way he spoke that made the exchange feel particularly genuine. Then he remembered the challenge that remained before him.
"He may not be so proud of me if it takes me 10 trips back and forth to the house to bring home all the fish I've caught. I didn't think how I'd get the fish back without him."
The old man furrowed his brow once again as he pondered the boy's predicament, but before he could speak, Breeden continued.
"I suppose it's okay to leave the rest of the fish in our boat and go get him to help me. I won't be long, just a handful of minutes each way. And even though I wanted to do this all by myself, I suppose I don't really have a choice, right?"
"I'm sure the fish will be fine,"
the old man chuckled softly.
"The morning is cool yet, and there don't appear to be any thieves about. Perhaps a wheelbarrow."
Breeden considered briefly and then laughed.
"What a great idea! I could probably manage without my father if I brought back the wheelbarrow. And the fish won't be alone as long either."
"By all means, then, you must hurry along. Don't let a foolish old man hold you up on your errand."
"Thank you, sir. Good morning."
The smile faded ever so slightly from the old man's eyes as Breeden turned and jogged up the road. 3. Old friends. Since Breeden's family lived but a short walk away, only a handful of minutes passed before he returned. When he stepped back onto the pier, he noticed that the old man was gone. For some reason, this didn't surprise him. There was something sad about the entire encounter, though he couldn't understand why. He shook off the hollow feeling and began loading his fish into the wheelbarrow. Half an hour later, Breeden arrived at home with a two-wheeled cart filled to the top with fat black and silver herring. He leaned the handle of his cart against the wall and walked over to a rain barrel at the corner of his house, grabbing the small pail from a hook hung well under the eave and scooping out some water to wash the scales and slime from his arms and hands. He would need his father's assistance to unload and prepare the herring for storage, but he would need to be clean before entering his home to ask for help. The two-story house before him had a narrow front that faced the main road, which followed the River Woodfall's bend. Their home was built on the bank of the river, and the rear of the house, his father's workshop, overhung the river by several feet. Above the simple wooden door that served as his home's entrance were the words Holt Andahar, Boatwright, and extending from the door jamb was a double-sided craftsman's placard displaying a picture of a carved sailboat, the hull painted cobalt blue and the sail painted white. The front stoop was swept clear of debris, and the plaster and timber exterior appeared freshly whitewashed. Breeden gave one last glance to the load of fish and opened the front door to enter his house. Upon stepping inside, Breeden took care in wiping his feet on a mat of bristles and then walked toward the kitchen. He could hear his father in animated conversation down the length of the hallway. Then his mother's laugh rang out. Breeden was surprised at the unusual energy he sensed. That's odd, he thought. They were happy people, but he just didn't think of them as people who laughed all the time. And he couldn't remember the last time he'd heard such genuine mirth in their voices. Then a deep rumbling sound, as of a boat rubbing against a submerged rock, issued from the kitchen. Breeden couldn't be sure, but he thought the sound might have contained words. He picked up his pace and approached the kitchen doorway. And then he saw the giant. He was seated on a workbench that had been pulled into the kitchen from his father's shop at the back of the house, likely because no chair in the home would have been large enough to accommodate his massive frame. Even seated as he was, his tremendous head brushed the ceiling as he shifted in his seat. His features were like those of a human, though not in the same proportion. His nose, for example, was much broader than even a 10-foot human's would have been. His ears were massive and pointed at the top, like an elf's. Two, his brownish-orange skin was rough and craggy, like the shell of a walnut. And his deeply recessed eyes looked very small, and even smaller for being so heavily shadowed by a prominent brow. His hair was black and curly, and his spring-like locks hung loosely about his head. By contrast, Breeden's mother and father looked like children, seated as they were in the presence of this enormous figure. Breeden's father had sandy blonde hair that was quietly and almost unnoticeably transitioning to gray and white by turns. He had a roundish head, red cheeks more often than not, and bright, intelligent blue eyes. He shared with Breeden a smile that turned up at only one side. His mother had brown hair, hazel green eyes like Breeden's, and a warm and beautiful face that had weathered the years well enough that she looked far younger than her husband, despite the fact that she was his senior by almost 2 years. After Breeden stood gaping in the doorway for a few timeless moments, his mother finally noticed his arrival and rose to free him from his frozen state. "Aegir," she introduced, "this is our son, Breeden. When was the last time you visited us? I don't believe you ever had a chance to meet him.
Breeden, say hello to our dear friend, Ager.
Breeden looked the giant in the eye and found he could not speak. Without standing, Ager smiled at the young man and inclined his head slightly, rumbling so low that Breeden could feel the words in his chest.
Greetings, Breeden. It is an honor to meet you as a young man.
Breeden didn't register the greeting, and even allowing for his youth, his stupor was becoming awkward. His father rose then and guided him to a chair.
I'm sorry, friend. My son is still young and hasn't seen your kind before. But I suppose that's pretty obvious, eh?
Ager waved his hand to dismiss Breeden's father's concerns.
No worry, Holtandahar. A day will come, I hope, when the two of us will sail Long Lake together as friends. But the boy is young, as you say, and I have come unannounced.
With these words, the giant rose slowly, hunching as he did so as to ensure he didn't strike his head on the high ceiling.
Don't go.
The words from Breeden were hardly audible. When all eyes in the room had turned to hear him better, he managed a bit louder.
Stay at least until I've brought the fish in.
Breeden's father laughed softly.
Fish indeed! The boy's wits have returned, and he is his father's practical son. The herring run must have begun, Ager. We must help Breeden with his catch.
In no time at all, and with Ager's assistance, despite the protest from Breeden's mother, they had the fish in three large barrels, soaking in brine. They could store the fish in this way for many weeks, and could take their time in drying the fish and wrapping them for more durable storage. All agreed that Breeden's haul was unexpectedly large and would certainly last through to next year's run. Breeden had loosened up while they worked and had begun to ask questions of Ager. They were innocuous questions at first.
Where do you live? Do your mountains truly reach the clouds?
And they became bolder as the morning progressed. By the time they were finished cleaning up and were once again seated in the kitchen, Breeden was asking more of the types of questions you might expect from a 16-year-old boy.
How many stones can you lift? Are the giant women as big as a giant men? Do they breathe fire? How about giant babies? Are they as big as I am now? How many apples can you eat in one sitting? Can you swim, or do you sink if you fall in the water?
Giants were known as a race for their patience, and Ager was no exception. He amused himself and Breeden's parents by displaying his dry wit in responding to the less tactful questions Breeden posed. To the question about giant women breathing fire, he responded,
"Upon occasion, and far too often for my comfort."
And to the question about whether or not he could swim, he responded,
"I sink slower than a stone, but faster than I care for."
In most cases, Breeden was already thinking of the next question, hardly registering each answer given. And before long, Breeden's parents were laughing openly, unable to contain themselves while observing the back and forth. Eventually, Breeden tired of asking questions in such rapid succession, and without being conscious of it, he began to ask ones that required more thought and time on Ager's part to respond.
What do you do for fun?
Spawned a lengthy monologue by Ager about his favorite hobbies, walking and sailing, both of which he claimed were made more pleasant by the company of his pipe. Ager became more at ease as he spoke of home. When he talked of walking in the mountains, he painted a vivid picture of pastoral serenity, high and vast slopes of green pastures overlooking a rocky coastline, and the lapis waters crashing into pure white foam at the land's edge. His deep and sonorous voice projected the scale and sweep of the mountains and the might of the ocean better than Breeden thought a human's possibly could. He felt the images come together in his mind as the giant spoke, until he must surely have the sight captured just as the giant saw it himself.
When he spoke of the sea, Ager changed the timbre of his voice, and his words became an endless horizon, reefing sails and clanging tackle, and the hollow booming of a ship's hull slapping against the waves. He lowered it once again, and a storm swept in from leagues away, darkening the sky and bringing with it stinging drops of heavy rain. The laughter of Breeden's parents was forgotten, and his mother's mouth hung open along with those of Breeden and his father. Breeden looked in his mother's eyes and could see the enchantment being wrought by the seafaring giant's voice. When Aegir finally did stop talking, the entire family remained silent for a long moment, allowing the images in their minds to dissipate at their own pace. It would be weeks before Breeden would find that the images had faded beyond his ability to recall them in such detail. And he would never forget the emotions left behind by the giant's view of his home, devotion to the land, awe at the world's beauty, and respect for the dwarfing and unknowable power of nature. In a sudden and surprising revelation, Breeden realized that he wanted to accompany Aegir when the giant left for home the next day. 4. A diversion. The next morning, Breeden allowed himself the rare opportunity to sleep in. Along with the fact that he'd been up so very early for the past week and a half, he'd also worked harder than normal the day before, and his whole family had stayed up late talking with the giant Aegir. When he had finally gone to sleep, he slept deeply and awoke somewhat stiff, but otherwise well recovered. His father and Aegir were sitting at the kitchen table when he found his way down the stairs, a few small pieces of sausage, cheese, and bread remaining on a board between them. He supposed they hadn't been there all night, but had gone to bed after him and risen before him. But then they looked somewhat tired, so he couldn't be sure. They appeared to be involved in a much more serious conversation than the ones from the night before, and Breeden caught repeated references to the boy. He understood quickly enough that they were talking about him. "Good morning," Breeden projected the words to make his father and the giant aware of his arrival. He'd been told many times before not to sneak up on people. Usually when his father was alone in his workshop, and Breeden's sudden arrival might cause a startled mishap in carving or the careful alignment of delicate pieces. Breeden's mother had boiled some eggs for him, and she brought them to the table as he moved to sit down. "Good morning, sleepyhead," she said playfully.
"Good morning, young Breeden,"
the giant boomed.
"Good morning, son."
His father wore an odd half-smirk as he spoke the words, and Breeden became suspicious. Breeden paused in the act of sliding his chair back from the table and couldn't help himself. "What is it?" His father beamed at him and seemed to discard his first and even second response before continuing.
"Well, after such a demanding day yesterday, I thought that perhaps you could forego your chores today."
Breeden became immediately excited, but didn't dare show it until he understood the smirk. He decided not to respond, to see if there was more that his father would share. It didn't take long.
"Our giant friend here has not come strictly for a social visit, but is placed in order as well. And the material and equipment I have at hand will not be sufficient for the job. It seems we will need a journey to the market to purchase what we can and to arrange for the rest."
Now Breeden was excited, and he decided the smirk might not hold a nasty surprise after all, but could be a cousin to the smirk his father wore at Belltide or on Breeden's birthday. His smile broke wide at the prospect of visiting the market with his father. It was something his family rarely felt the need to do, since they were mostly self-sufficient for their day-to-day tools and supplies. His mother would head into town for womanly things every so often, dresses and such, he supposed, but that was pretty much the extent of it.
When Breeden did go to market, it was most often for something specific, a there-and-back-again affair, so to speak. But something about the way his father spoke, or about his smile, made this trip sound somehow more expansive, as if the list were a long and difficult one, and they might have to spend a good amount of time seeking among the wares of the various merchants. Or at least Breeden allowed himself to imagine the trip as such. Breeden's father continued,
"We'll be seeing off Aegir at the deep water piers before we leave for the market, as soon as you have a chance to wash your face and eat your breakfast."
In minutes, they were ready to go. Breeden was sad to see the giant go, despite having met him only the day before. In that single evening, the giant had brought a rare and sweet joy to the lives of his mother and father, and had become as natural a presence in their home as another member of the family. The walk to the deep water piers was more than twice as far as the pier Breeden had used the day before, but the distance passed quickly. Aegir and Breeden's father filled the time discussing the details of his order, his father plying him with more questions about the design and construction. Aegir answered most of these with,
"I trust your work, Holt Andahar."
His mother having said her goodbyes at their home, Breeden and his father stood on the pier as the giant maneuvered his boat away from them. The boat was of a size that Aegir could just manage to sail it by himself, with a tiller, four sheets, and a knotted line to raise the keel, should he need to. The fin-shaped keel was unusual, to say the least. Breeden had seen only a few like it before on Long Lake. The need for a keel of any depth was less critical when navigating lakes and rivers than sailing the open ocean. Common wisdom held that seagoing vessels needed a sturdy and fixed keel to weather the forces at work beyond the coastline. But Aegir appeared to manage just fine with a more flexible alternative to both extremes. The giant's craft was fast disappearing from view to the north. Breeden thought of the long journey that lay ahead for him. It would be several days before he reached his home. Then it occurred to him, as he considered the relaxed and powerful ease with which Aegir controlled the vessel, that the giant was already there. With a final wave of his arms above his head, Breeden's father decided it was time to head over to the Riddersall Market. 5. Talents Revealed. The market was a frantic place, and it always took Breeden a few minutes to acclimate himself to it. The hawkers would yell loudly in competition for the handful of buyers. The animals would bleat, or neigh, or crow. The pungent aromas of a local favorite, sache, marinated meat or fish sold on sticks, would compete with the manure, the tanning chemicals, and the perfumes. The cloth merchants' wares would strike a garish contrast in their rainbow hues to the dull duns and browns of most of the other booths. It was a mad and unpredictable scene, even on a calm day, and even in such a small city as Riddersall. And it was even madder to Breeden for the fact that his days usually consisted of helping his mother and father around the house and workshop. As an only child with no close friends his own age, Breeden led a very isolated and uneventful life. The market was anything but uneventful. The giant's project called for ironwood, which would quickly dull a blade made of poor quality steel. Breeden's father explained that the blacksmiths in town would not have forges capable of producing a high enough heat to achieve the hardness required for the giant's job, but perhaps the traders at market might have some workable tools among their wares. He reminded Breeden, too, that the chisels and saw blades he sought would need to be larger than average due to the scale of the project. They started by looking for any signs of tools at all among the tables and stalls of the merchants, and then they scouted each stall that did to see if chisels, saws, or draw knives might be among them. In front of a garishly painted tinker's wagon,
they spotted a large spread of woodworking tools of all sorts and in all types of condition. The tools were spread out in a fan surrounding a battered wooden toolbox that looked as if it would contain the entire collection. Breeden spotted a flat box at one side, opened to reveal a gorgeous set of 6 silver chisels filigreed with creeping vines and flowers along the tops of the blades.
"I see them, too."
Breeden's father had followed his son's widening eyes and also appeared impressed with the set's beauty. The tinker saw their interest and reacted.
"You won't find a finer set of chisels this side of the Eastern Sea. Handcrafted by the dwarven smith Bertil, these chisels have no rival in all the land."
Breeden's father smirked good-naturedly at the man.
"You don't say."
He lifted one chisel delicately from the velvet-padded box, noting the obvious quality of even the box itself.
Breeden wriggled himself between his father and the table, and he picked up one of the chisels, turning it over in his hands. He seemed to be lost for a moment as he did so, but his father was too busy to notice the intensity of his son's examination as he began the dance of determining a fair price for the chisels.
"I should say these chisels are a bit too fine for the kind of work I intend to put them to. Do you have anything sturdier about?"
The tinker didn't miss a beat.
"Indeed, I have other chisels, sir. But none compare in beauty and function to these dwarven-made blades. They are a special dwarven alloy that polishes as brightly as silver, but cuts as the finest steel. I offer you a blow or two with one of my mallets, if you'd like. I'm sure I could produce a scrap of wood for you to test their edge."
"Thanks for that, but I'm sure those tools are far beyond my humble means. Could I see some of your others?"
The tinker realized Breeden's father would not be an easy dupe and shifted to a more straightforward approach.
"Indeed, sir. I believe I have an odd assortment of bits and ends in my wagon. Allow me a moment."
When the tinker had disappeared into his wagon, Breeden's father spoke.
"Here is where he plans to take his time so we can examine the fine silver chisels more closely, and he will watch us from a window to see that we do. So we won't give him the satisfaction. Go ahead and put your chisel back."
Breeden grudgingly set down the chisel and commented, "They are not as fine as he thinks anyway. The metal is cheap and ill-formed beneath the silver. They wouldn't hold up under real use and won't serve for what we need." His father was puzzled at the certainty with which Breeden had made the statement, and he wondered where Breeden's imagination had come up with such a firm and reasonable-sounding assertion. He gave his son an odd look.
"They look fine enough to me. Why do you say that?"
Breeden couldn't explain, thinking it as obvious as rain, and was surprised at his father's question.
"Can't you tell by looking at them?
On the surface, they look pretty enough, but underneath the silver, the metal is weak."
Breeden felt his response was weak, but he didn't have the words to better describe what he meant. His father thought back to a similar conversation they'd had a handful of months ago. The handle on one of his mauls had split, and he had asked Breeden to choose a piece of replacement stock. He knew that among the scraps of wood, there was a likely piece close to the right proportions for the job, which would require minimal whittling. When Breeden had come back with a much longer piece of wood with a fat knot at one end, he had asked his son if there were none better shaped for the purpose. Breeden's response had stuck with him. He didn't remember the exact words necessarily, but the intention was clear. "You'll only have to carve this one later anyway, since that other piece is bound to split." As now, he had asked Breeden why he believed that to be the case, and Breeden had given him roughly the same response.
"Can't you see that it's going to break?"
At the time, he'd chalked it up to youthful imagination and had made use of the wood Breeden had brought to him. As it turned out, the knot served as a perfect knurl at the butt of the handle to keep the heavy and long-handled maul in hand during strenuous use. And he had to admit
that the grain and density of the wood was excellent for the job. What stuck with him was a sense of wonder at how the boy had made such a judgment. He considered himself a good judge of wood and knew the skill to be a combination of art, or more accurately, practiced intuition and simple experience. But despite Breeden's growing up in a household where working wood was practiced with great care and, all modesty aside, great skill, there was something special about his boy. The tinker appeared from within his wagon, carrying a large burlap bag that clinked dully in his left hand as he approached. He unceremoniously dumped the contents on the table. It was full of chisels. Breeden's father thought the tinker might have been gathering the tools together after all, and not watching them from the window as he'd told his son. Or perhaps the tinkers were a more organized lot than he gave them credit for. Breeden scanned the tools and mentally discarded almost all of them. His father pretended to examine them himself, but he was suddenly more interested in watching his son. The tinker caught the exchange and didn't appear to know what to make of it, but his face revealed that he thought he was somehow being conned. Breeden had already decided upon four of the larger and wider chisels, two of which appeared to be mated with each other, but he waited for his father before saying anything. He seemed to have finished with whatever sort of evaluation he intended when Breeden's father spoke up.
"Well, before I consider any of these rustic blades, why don't we discuss your best price on the dwarven set?"
The tinker's eyes narrowed. He hadn't expected the question, but he recovered.
"I couldn't let them go for less than 1.5 crowns.
Breeden's father blanched at the price. He had expected the tinker to aim high, but never would have expected him to go that high. But the price was on the table, and Breeden's father resumed the dance.
"I should say that that's more than I make in a season, sir. I would need to borrow some copper for half that price. The best I could manage with the coins on my person is 25 commons.
25 commons being 12.5 less than 1/4 the starting price, the tinker feigned insult.
"Surely you can't be serious. Why, at 10 silvers I would sell them at a loss, never mind less than 3.
Breeden's father feigned being deflated by the assertion.
"I suppose they're out of my league, then. I truly can't afford more than 25 commons. How about these lesser quality blades? How much are you charging for each of these?"
The tinker responded without thought.
"Make me your best offer and I will consider it."
His father turned casually to Breeden.
"Do any of these blades strike your fancy, son? It's okay to say no if none are to your liking."
"Yes, sir. There are a few of passing quality."
"How many?"
4. The tinker's frown grew deeper as his suspicion he was being conned became more pronounced. He appeared helpless, watching the father and son exchange words.
"I'll give you 5 commons apiece for any 4 my son chooses, not including the silver ones, of course. That's 20 commons, nearly the same price I offered you for the dwarven set."
Now the tinker looked truly surprised. His face had become angrier, and he had seemed prepared to lash out at Breeden and his father. And then, in a moment, so fast that Breeden wasn't sure he'd read the man's growing anger correctly, the man smiled.
20 coppers it is. Go ahead and pick your chisels, son."
Breeden looked at his father first, to make sure it was okay, and at his nod, he picked up the 4 chisels he'd already selected. The tinker paid little attention to which chisels Breeden had chosen, but watched his father extract the 20 copper commons he had been promised from a leather case attached to his belt. When the transaction was complete and they were walking away from the man's stall, Breeden observed that the tinker's smile was gone, and he looked as if he was trying to figure out whether he'd been had. Breeden guessed the man thought the transaction far too easy. Breeden's father glanced back and saw the look. Good. May he always wonder whether he got the better of us this day. They turned a corner and were well out of sight of the tinker's booth when his father stopped walking and asked Breeden to pass him the chisels so he could examine them more carefully. His father looked around almost nervously and then pulled one out of the bag and gave it a once-over. The chisel looked serviceable and the metal was free of rust, and it felt good in his hand. But there was nothing about it that struck him as remarkably different from many of the other blades the tinker had offered for sale.
So, what made you choose these four from among all those dozens of tools?
Breeden shrugged his shoulders. They are aligned better than the others. He struggled for a moment before continuing. Like straight rows of barley versus crooked ones, I suppose. And there are no obvious weak spots in the metal. Like missing stalks of barley in a field.
Do you mean to say that you can see inside them?
Not exactly, but I can feel the flaws. Like when you wrap a cracked stick against a wall and you feel it vibrate. Only I don't need to hit the wall.
His father shook his head and spun the chisel about in his hand in a practiced motion as he tried to come to grips with the situation.
Well, unfortunately, I don't believe we'll find any answers out here. Let's talk about this more when we get home. And we've got one more stop to make before that.
Where are we going?
His father smiled.
We're going to see about getting you into school.
Breeden was not expecting this response and literally stopped in his tracks.
School?
But his father had nothing more to offer than a wink and a "Come along, then!" And he grabbed his son by the shoulder and started him moving again.
6. Debts and Promises. As long as it had been, and as infrequently as they went to the market, they went inside the castle's inner bailey even less often. Breeden had been to Mass at the monastery only a handful of times in his short life, and he was excited at the prospect of visiting once again. Schooling, on the other hand, wasn't something he'd ever thought about before. He knew that his father had studied with the monks for a short period in his youth, but for some reason, Breeden hadn't thought he'd be afforded the same opportunity. He wasn't sure what it would mean for him, didn't know what he didn't know, but he was excited anyway. If nothing else, he'd be seeing a lot more of the castle. By virtue of the route they took, they were already well into Riddersall Castle's outer bailey when they left the market. The market was to the right of the main thoroughfare leading into the inner bailey. The main approach to the castle was from the north and west, the land route from Arlon, and the road forked in front of the outer bailey into a short road down to the deep water docks, where Long Lake formed a sheltered cove west of the River Woodfall's mouth. When Breeden and his father joined up with the main road, there were few people about. Commoners were the norm, people dressed in homespun, albeit well-made and clean, and the occasional noble or wealthy merchant could be seen entering or leaving their carriages. But the nobility of Riddersall were small in number and quiet in their comings and goings. Breeden had heard tales of Arlon's grandeur and the arrogance of nobles who lived in the city, but he had a hard time picturing it. His parents had taught him that all people are good at heart, and that even the occasional rude customer or pompous noble might well have their own problems, and he shouldn't presume to judge them based upon one bad day. Today they encountered no nobles, rude or otherwise, and they proceeded south along the beautifully maintained road, one of the very few cobbled roads in the area, admiring the budding trees and beautiful homes that lined the roadway. The houses, as elsewhere in the city, were spaced close together, leaving enough room for two or three to pass abreast. More often than not, the top floors extended out over the first floors and overhung the sidewalk. As Breeden and his father approached the inner gate to the castle grounds, the crowds diminished further, and only a handful of people could be found walking about outside. The monastery was a massive and prominent structure, and of all the buildings within the inner bailey, it was second in size only to the keep itself. The building of the one God's religion had a tall square tower with large round stained glass windows on each face. The windows were high enough that they could be seen above the keep's battlements, which were themselves the height of 10 men. The entire complex consisted of the cathedral itself and numerous connected outbuildings. At some point in the past, the builders of the castle, or perhaps an overly bold monarch, had decided that the keep's 2 baileys would be more than enough defense against an attack, and that the comfort of the nobility in traversing the courtyard via a covered walkway in foul weather was more important than maintaining the integrity of the castle's defenses. The covered walkway extended from the western face of the monastery to a postern gate at the left rear corner of the castle. To the left of a large double-doored entrance on the northeastern face of the monastery was a small footpath leading to one of the outbuildings and its much smaller and humbler door. It was to this door that Breeden's father directed their steps. Breeden didn't know what to expect and glanced at his father for reassurance, but his father wore an unusual expression. He'd have called it nervousness if he'd ever seen his father wear it before. Was his father intimidated at the thought of entering the monastery? Or was it the person or people they were going to meet who caused him to be unsure of himself? In any event, Breeden became much less confident himself. His father was a rock. If his father had reason to worry, then surely he did as well. But his father didn't appear to notice the concern he had caused in his focus on the task at hand. He knocked on the door firmly 3 times using the heavy iron ring that served as a knocker. The weight felt endless to Breeden, but within about a minute he thought he detected footsteps beyond the door, and shortly thereafter it opened, revealing a middle-aged cleric in a simple robe of undyed homespun wool. Brother Cedric had answered the door himself. He was a sturdy man, looking to Breeden to be about his father's age, perhaps a bit older. His hair was cut as if a bowl had been placed on his head, and everything showing beneath the bowl's rim had been removed down to the pale skin of his skull. He had black hair heavily peppered with gray and white, a prominent round nose, and simply enormous hands, which enveloped Breeden's own when they greeted each other. He smiled warmly upon recognizing Breeden's father.
"Welcome, Holt Anderhar. It is a pleasure to see you, and all the more so for it not being a church holy day. Good day, Brother Cedric." He smiled as he spoke, and some of his nervous tension seemed to leave him at Cedric's words, despite the small jab about his church attendance.
"I'd like you to meet my son, Breeden."
"It is a pleasure, my son. Truly, it is a pleasure. And he is a blessing upon you, Holt."
"Thank you, brother. He is a good boy. How is Marlene?"
"She is well, brother. She asked that I give you her best wishes."
"I'm certain she did. Quite certain."
His face became more serious for a moment, as if to assure Breeden and his father that his respect for the mother and wife was a given. And with the more businesslike air still in place, he continued.
"So what is it that brings you to the monastery on a day of work, and with your son in tow, no less? Do you wish to submit him to me for punishment of some mortal sin?"
Fortunately, Breeden was accustomed to sarcasm and caught the glint in Brother Cedric's eye.
"Close, Brother Cedric. I wish to submit him to you, but not for punishment. I would ask that you take him in and teach him as you did me."
Cedric responded encouragingly.
"I would be honored, Holt. You came to me a bit too old to teach all I wanted to you. But your son is young enough to have a full course of subjects, not just numbers and writing as you had."
Breeden's father smiled, obviously relieved at such an immediate and heartfelt response. Cedric continued,
I have a few students already, and recently took on two more, due to start in a few months. But I don't see why I couldn't take on another. Six students might make things a bit hectic at times, but I believe that any child of Holt Anderhar will be far more boon than burden to my little group.
As his father and the cleric exchanged further pleasantries, Breeden considered the fact that Cedric had also taught his father, and it dawned on him that he'd always known this, and yet he hadn't thought to consider Brother Cedric's age. He must be a good deal older than he looked to have taught his father so many years ago, and yet he really did look no older than his father. The conversation waned a bit after the business at hand and accompanying small talk were completed, and Cedric appeared to sense an unaccustomed awkwardness in his former charge.
"We will commence as autumn begins, the day after the equinox, and we will make allowance for any who need leave for the harvest. But you look as though poised for another question, Holt. Was there anything else?"
Breeden's father seemed to screw up his courage to respond.
"I wish to make a donation, Brother Cedric. To what degree may I contribute to the good work of this monastery? Will 10 crowns do for now?"
Breeden perked up at mention of more money than he'd ever seen in one place at the same time, and Brother Cedric looked suddenly pained, seeing a good man struggle over a discussion involving what must be to him a considerable sum of gold.
"Sir, I will gladly accept your donation, now or at any other time, especially one so generous as yours. But you are not committed or required to donate. It is the work of God to educate youth, and all who wish to be so educated may do so here in his house."
A strange look came over Breeden's father, and he responded slowly, carefully.
"When I was a boy, Hugh Robinet told me that a noble had taken pity on me and provided my guarantee in gold, and that this was how I was able to sit in on your lessons with the children of nobility such as him. He held it over my head until my final days of studying with you."
It was obvious that he wished to go further, that there was underlying pain associated with the memories he now confronted.
"Do you mean to tell me that this was not the case? That all these years I have labored under the burden of my own unworthiness, believing myself indebted to a man who does not exist, and it was nothing more than the spiteful fabrication of a spoiled child?"
Cedric's expression became quite serious.
"It would appear so. Robinet? I always did have difficulty with that troublesome boy, now doubtless risen to a troublesome duke. This is not an excuse, believe me, but to undo the influence of parents is hard work, and from his father, he had a mean streak in him from the very first. I am sorry, Holt."
Breeden's father shook his head, his shaken confidence gone and replaced with a new determination. He stepped forward and placed the heavy pouch in Cedric's hands.
"Take the coin, brother. I saved my earnings against this day so that my son would never have to suffer the humiliation I did at Robinet's hands, and so he would be assured of, or so I hoped my meager coin would cover the cost of, schooling under your tutelage. And now I find that it was all a lie. I should have expected it, I suppose. He always was a cruel and cunning boy. But I took his words as truth because I did feel unworthy. It was too easy to do, I guess, being the only commoner among your students. And to be honest..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.